if you do, and that's why our sons are struggling, because that's the industry all four of them are
Right,
in.
and they're raising families. They've got responsibilities when the work day is done, other than work. They have big responsibilities when they go home. But these people have dogs, and they bring their dog, and Amazon, you know, most of these tech companies cater to that because they want their people to enjoy work and be at work and have that connected. So it's basically their
But it's rather
family.
brilliant because they don't really have to go home since their family's now with them at work.
Yep. Basically, they're bringing their little family to work, on the family on the leash.
So our children, same age group, are coming home and they're taking their kids to practice, soccer practice. We get the videos of, see, we have on just the one son, we have four videos
our
from
kids
different
are being
activities.
Soccer parents, basically,
Right.
which means soccer, basketball, gymnastics, you name it, play practices and all of that.
Speaking of which.
So we see a contrast just in our own kids, but it was really interesting to sit down and for an hour watch what's happening. And I had to think about, you know, I've grown up in the Seattle area for almost my entire life, and I've been in downtown so many times. The landscape has changed.
Right.
You didn't even see dogs on leashes in Seattle 30 years ago.
And that's a physical landscape.
Physically,
I'd say
it's changed the landscape.
The social landscape has dramatically changed. These four things we talked about, the apprenticeships, careers, military, and marriage, researchers are saying that's what largely protected the young adults from dangerous influences and their own worst impulses.
And I would say people getting, you know, millennials getting a dog, that is a sense of to protection, but is it lasting? You know, what is the long-term benefit? So, they're out of the foxhole.
So, again, the researchers are arguing, and my notes on this one is they don't have an environment. They lack a fully developed foxhole, what I call an environment. They call foxhole. So without the spouses, without the responsibilities, the mortgage payments, toddlers to chase around, games to go to, these young people have the freedom to decide what to do with their time, what behaviors to engage in, and what they don't. And without the fully developed brain, they don't have any structure in which to guide them. And that's where we're flailing. I have actually clients in here who are in that age group who are financially doing well, but they're miserable.
So can I throw a little wrench into all this?
Well, that's not unusual.
I know. Here it comes. Is that when we were going through this, and that we can't autobiograph
now,
this
before
situation.
Before you say it, but forget everything you know about what it's like to be this age, because it doesn't work because it was you.
When we launched, we didn't know our brains were underdeveloped. So neuroscience.
I did.
You did?
Yeah, you told me often.
So unfair. It wasn't out there that the less than 25-year-old brain was really fully developed as prominently as it is now.
I agree with
that.
We've
pretty much told our kids, your brain is not fully developed. And so therefore, they're acting underdeveloped.
God, that's fascinating.
Yeah.
So we messed our kids up again.
And we just faked it.
Well, we didn't know differently, right?
Yeah. We faked it
and
made it.
Very interesting. So years ago, again, we're going back 20 plus years here, 20 to 30 years. The average age, no, I'm sorry, this goes back to the 50s. The average age for American men to get married was 22. The average age for women to get married was 20. Last year, 2018, the average age for a first marriage in the United States is 30 for men and 27 for women. And keep in mind, I deal with that segment a lot. And the men, as a general rule, are not in a hurry at all. But many of the women are. Now, hurry is not the right word, but they wouldn't mind getting married.
I would say for most of the women, it's like, it's not okay to have that as a desire, but inside.
Socially, it's not okay.
Socially, it's unacceptable.
But in this office, it isn't.
It's not desirable to want to get married in your 20s, but women will do it by age 27 because of the biological clock factor.
Oh,
and then suddenly it's okay about 27, 28. So you got to remember, I went and did my master's
as
a 50-year-old with a bunch of 20-somethings with this age group. And it was very interesting to watch, like, who could really talk about marriage? And some of them were right at that point. And there were several weddings that actually happened that year.
Okay.
But they were 27, 28-year-old women, but none of the boys got married.
So let's go to the research. It's funny how I'm just going through this one and you keep bringing this up. So the researcher says he sees many emerging adults replacing traditional milestones with a whole lot of self-centeredness and risk-taking, or what's called time-wasting behavior. Ask young people what they should be doing in their 20s, and they'll tell you that this is the time and period to party, explore relationships, which they really don't understand at all, to travel, and to enjoy being lazy. They see this time period as being about anything but becoming an adult.
And it's interesting because I don't think that they're the ones driving these expectations, this new set of norms, because it's become socially unacceptable for parents to have kids that take on responsibilities too early. I don't know if you're aware of that.
Let's do that again.
So it is not socially acceptable amongst parents to have kids who are taking on responsibilities.
Oh, that's what you're getting. Yeah, that's where you're getting it.
I can tell and sense when people realize that my kids got married in their young 20s and now they're in their 30s and they're done having kids.
And we have
X amount of grandchildren.
Almost a dozen grandchildren.
And it's peculiar. That's very peculiar to them. And it's not socially acceptable. It's not okay to say, yes, my 22-year-old son got married and they're happy and they're ready to launch. That doesn't come off that way.
There's a line in the research that says women today are encouraged like never before to pursue higher education and careers. And I think that's awesome. I have no problem with that.
And there's a huge benefit to it.
There is. I agree with that. The challenge is the balance
right.
between where does the man fit in this one? You know, men are saying there's no purpose to get married. If you're a Christian and you have morals, then sex would be a reason. But other than that, and this is literally in the research, they're saying we don't understand why we need to get married. There's no purpose behind it, because raising a family, having children, having responsibilities, connecting with the world, being a part of the world, being service oriented, these are all traditional values.
Okay. And let's contrast this. The emerging adulthood, they're exploring and they're really not taking on responsibilities. If in this generation, if a male takes on the responsibility of marriage, therefore comes children, his responsibilities are not even like yours in marriage. It's triple fold. So they go from no responsibility to huge responsibility. They go from
Let me put context into this one.
It's just this geometric weight on them.
At least from our observations. Whereas when we got married, it was somewhat traditional in that you stayed at home for many, many years. But worse,
and it's somewhat traditional that I do the cooking and blah, blah, blah.
Well, only because I don't know how.
Okay. Well, there it is.
But when you're gone, I seem to live.
You never starve.
No. And I don't complain. But you're the one who gets frustrated because I didn't eat all the food that you made for me and prepared for me. It was beautifully done, but it took effort.
It took me years to stop making freezer meals and expecting you to put them in the microwave.
It's a lot of work.
I know. I would do all this work and I'd be gone for a week and come back and say, what? I cooked for you? And you're like, I did fine on Toastios or whatever.
Oh, anyways, the point being that I could come home from work and I didn't have to still go do the shopping, do the cooking, do the laundry, take everyone everywhere. And we're starting to see that a lot more in the male. So the pendulum swing, whereas in the 50s and 60s, the man was the, you know, he'd come home,
the traditional breadwinner,
open the paper up and say, I'm tired. It's been a hard day. And then the wife had to do everything, which was really a wrong pendulum swing. But then it swung the other way, and it seems like it's an over on this side. And maybe it's just stuff that we see because that's what we're exposed to. But I do find interesting parallels with that one. So what I want to do, let's wrap this segment up, because the next segment we're going to talk about flourishers. How to create an environment where they can flourish. How do you escape the gravity of this nothingness? Don't know where you're going, no direction. Because if you have no direction, you're going to get there.
And I think we really defined if we're a parent of an emerging adult, the challenges that they're facing, the societal norms that have been changed, and how the environment has changed. But that doesn't mean that that has to be the environment you choose.
So let's leave with this. This is today. I had a 19-year-old in my office yesterday, and his mother came in. She just said, what do I do, Dr. Hammer? And I said, be neutral. Stop judging him. Stop telling him what to do. I didn't say it in those words. I gave her the technique of flipping. But I said, this is the most important thing. And he's over here just bobbleheading. Please, mom, Stop telling me what to do. Don't tell me this is what you did as a child.
It's not going to work. And maybe we can at least have a little empathy for the understanding of why this generation is struggling with anxiety and depression.
And moms and dads, you're the primary reason. So let's just have you start working on you so they can work on them. So thanks for listening. And this is where we're going to. You're 100% responsible for your happiness, joy, and well-being. The next segment's where we're going to address it. Thanks so much for listening.
Inside my head, I try to turn it down, but I can't quite drown it out. I'm tortured every day, these never-ending worries pulling on my sleeve. So many times.